So we come to the multiplication theorem on probability. If E and F are any two events and S is the sample space, then E intersection F represents what? E and F. That means occurrence of E as well as F. That is simultaneous occurrence. Okay? That is simultaneous occurrence of E and F. E as well as F. E and F. Okay? Okay. It is also denoted by EF. If I write EF, it means E intersection F, E into F, sort of. Okay? Now, what is my E intersection F? What is the probability of occurrence of E intersection F? See, we know that PE such that F is equal to PE intersection F upon PF. So, PE intersection F is PF multiplied by PE such that F. Now see, this makes a tremendous sense, you know. It makes a tremendous sense, and in my opinion, it should be taught somewhere in class 9th or 10th, not here. Why? It says the probability of occurrence of E and F is equal to probability of occurrence of F, that means F has already occurred, followed by that, multiplied by that, probability of occurrence of E such that F has occurred. You understand? No. See, it says F has already occurred, and then occurrence of E such that F has occurred. Now many a times what happens, and we'll come to a very formal definition of that, the events are not independent. What do you mean by independence of events? When occurrence of one in no way affects the occurrence of the other. That is called independent event. Okay. Now it might so happen that occurrence of E gets affected by occurrence of F. It's quite possible. That's why they have written probability of E such that F has occurred. Okay. Probability of E such that F has occurred. Now as you will say, why should I use only this? Why not this? Probability of F such that E. Because our aim is to do what? To find P intersection F. Now P intersection F can come in two ways. When I put E such that F, or I put F such that E. Okay? If it is F such that E, then it is F intersection E upon P E. So P F intersection E is equal to P E. So P E into P F such that E. So these are two alternate forms, and we know that F intersection E is also E intersection F. That's why it is also P E into probability of F such that E has occurred. Do we get that point? All of you? So this will have two alternate forms, right? I'll write P intersection F is equal to probability of occurrence of F multiplied by occurrence of E such that F has occurred, or probability of occurrence of E followed by occurrence of F such that E has occurred. This is called the multiplication theorem on probability.
Okay. This is called the multiplication theorem of probability. You should always speak this English that I am speaking. What? Probability of occurrence of E as well as F is equal to probability of occurrence of F multiplied by probability of occurrence of E such that F has occurred. Okay. Don't just follow the formula. Now, what happens if there are more than two events? Okay. Multiplication theorem, if there are more than two events. Multiplication theorem. Multiplication theorem. If the number of events is more than two. Okay. Suppose it is E, F, G. Then probability of occurrence of E intersection F intersection G will be what? I say first whatever has occurred. Let us say first E has occurred. So probability of occurrence of E multiplied by probability of occurrence of E such that E has already occurred. Probability of occurrence of F such that E has already occurred, because yes, it has occurred. Multiplied by probability of occurrence of G such that EF. EF I had said is E intersection F. That means G such that E and F both have occurred. Right? If it had been another H, then it will be H such that E, F, G. Okay? So, it will keep on getting multiplied. You see, this we did commonsensically. Okay? Now, if you want to verify it, you should start expanding the RHS and see whether you get this. Okay? Whether you get this. And I will do that. So, let us see the RHS. RHS is P, E, into P F such that E into P G such that I'll now write it in expanded form. Okay. Okay. So this is P E into E intersection F. EF have occurred now. So P E into P F intersection E upon PE, no, into this intersection that P G intersection E intersection F upon P E intersection F. Now you see what happens. This cancels. What am I left with? E intersection F intersection G. So fine. What we were telling commonsensically actually holds rigorously from the analytical method. We are right. Mm-hmm. Now let us do an example. An urn contains 10 black and 5 white balls. 10 black and 5 white balls. Okay. Two balls are drawn from the urn one after the other without replacement. Two balls are drawn from the urn one after the other without replacement. Okay. What is the probability that both the balls are black? What is the probability? That both the balls are black. Okay. You'll have to define the events. What is the first event? E is first ball is black. First ball is black. F is second ball is black. Okay. And we are supposed to find what? P. Let me segregate this. We are supposed to find P E intersection F, is it not? Now that we know is P E into P F such that E. Okay. What is the probability of drawing the first black ball? Total number of balls is 15. And the number of black balls is 10. So 10 upon 15?
2 by 3.
So it is 10 upon 15. Just write it like that first. Okay. You should be actually writing these statements that there are 10 black balls and 15 first draw. Total 15 balls. So we can draw one black ball in 10 ways and the total number of ways in which it can be drawn is 15. So probability is 10 by 15. You should be writing this. There are marks for this. Multiplied by drawing the second such that the first has already been drawn. So now after you have drawn a black ball, many a times you will feel, you know what, how do I know whether the ball that I will draw is black? This is what used to confound me. Okay. But you do it deliberately with your eyes wide open. Okay. The probabilistic thing is being put in by this. Right. So it is 10 by 15. Now 9 balls, black balls are left, and the total number of balls are 14 only. So it becomes 9 into 14. So that becomes 9 upon 21. 3 by 7. Yes. Right. Okay. Fine. Simple to understand, but you should not lose sight of this. Whatever we are doing, it's very imperative, very important that you do that. You understand it. And you speak in words. Okay. You speak in words. Don't just rely on the formula. Otherwise, they'll mean nothing to you. Especially when we go ahead and do the base. Okay, it'll mean nothing to you. And first of all, the question itself is so chaotic that you'll kind of feel aghast. What to do? Fine. What if we had drawn the balls with the replacement? Then it would have become 10 by 15 into 10 by 15. Because then drawing of the second ball would have become independent of drawing the first ball. Correct. That means PF such that E would have become PF. Okay. E would have stopped mattering for it. The moment one event does not affect the other, those two events are said to be independent. It may so happen that this does not affect this, but this affects this. Then they are not independent. So this should not affect this, and this should not affect that. Okay?
You know the difference between affect and effect. Affect and effect. What is it?
And there are sound effects. There are sound effects.
So one is a noun, another is the verb. This is the verb, this is the noun. Fine.